So let's get started and continue with our structural planes and directions that we dealt with last time. Just a few more terms to define structural planes and directions, because we'll be using these terms all the time, talking about the relationships of one structure to another. So today I want to talk about anterior. These are very simple. Posterior, dorsal, ventral. Let me turn these the other way so that they go with the one above. This is ventral and dorsal. So we'll show how these were derived so you know why they're used the way they are. If we take the human, of course we have two legs, animals, four. So if we look at the human, and this is back, and this is front. We've had the anatomical position. This will be anterior, front, and back will be posterior. If we take the little animal, who's down here on four legs, this is back. This is front, but the early anatomists called this dorsal and this ventral. Of course, if he stands up, then it will be like an anterior posterior. So the point is here, in today's world with the human, they use both dorsal, ventral, anterior, and posterior. So I just wanted you to be familiar, because we get into the nervous system and you use these interchangeably, because that's just the way things are now. One other terminology, this will be what's called a transverse plane. So if I have my individual, we take a plane that goes straight across. That's called transverse. So everything above the transverse will be superior. So above equals superior. Below equals what? Inferior, sure. I don't have to tell you, you can figure it out. But the point is, these are simple terms that we'll be using constantly with regard to our structures. So now we're going to introduce what we mean by tissues. What's the science of tissues called? Histology, right. I want you to learn to talk to me. You're used to sitting in a class and just writing. But I want you to use your vocal cords, right? So it's okay to talk back, because this is what you're going to have to do when you leave class. You've got to talk this language. And I want you to start at the beginning. So if I ask you a question, answer it. Sometimes you're wrong, but that's okay. We'll give you the right one if we can. So let's look at tissues. And you said the science of tissues is called histology. So what's a tissue? It's a mass of like cells. Tissue equals a mass of like cells. So would you believe that your bodies are made up of only four kinds of tissue? Your total body is divided into four kinds of tissue. So we have one, epithelial tissue. Epithelial tissue. Two, connective tissue. Connective tissue. Three, what's three? What other tissues are left? Muscle, muscular tissue. Let's put up three. Muscular tissue. What's four? Nervous tissue. Good. So, where do we find epithelial tissue? This is very general because we fill all this in with detail. But find epithelial, it covers the body. So you could quickly surmise that skin is an epithelial tissue. It will line the tubes within your body. We're going to see how much of us made up of tubes. So it will line tubes. An example will be your digestive tract from mouth to anus. Digestive tract will be lined with epithelium. Then the glands are made up of epithelial tissue. So glands, we'll see these as we study the numerous glands throughout your body. There are other areas of epithelial, but this gives you an example of where you find this kind of tissue. Now, connective tissue is the most varied of your tissues. Most varied. Connective tissue is characterized by cells, fibers, and a matrix. Cells, fibers, and a matrix. Only word you perhaps don't know there will be matrix. What is matrix? It's the intercellular substance. The intercellular substance. So it's going to differ with each type of connective tissue. So what will we find for our connective tissues? Examples? Bones. Bones are a connective tissue. Cartilage. Cartilage. Believe it or not, blood. Blood. These are examples. So you could ask, what's the matrix in blood? You know you have cells. What's the matrix? Plasma, the fluid, sure. It's the intercellular substance. So the matrix is the plasma. Just a different way of looking at all of these. So we get this brief introduction for these simple classifications of our tissues. Let's then look at muscular, and everybody knows muscular are just cells that are designed, cells to contract and relax. That's all muscle does. And then we have nerve tissue with the most varied types of cells. Cells will be sensing, taking in new information. They will be conducting, and they will be storing. And it doesn't do any good to store if we don't know how to retrieve. That's the real question. How do we retrieve information? retrieving. So these are very complex, phenomenal cells, our nerve cells. So this gives us a brief outline of just these four types of tissues make up this whole phenomenal body. So now we're ready to start a system. We're going to start with the skeletal system. So what's the science of bones called? I hear mumbles, but nothing clear. Osteology. Osteology. Science of bones. Osteology. We just finished saying that bones are a connective tissue, so we know we're going to have cells, fibers, and a matrix. We will learn details of these later. Right now, we're just introducing the system. What makes the matrix differ from other tissues? It has calcium in it, right? So the matrix has calcium. The compound which forms the matrix is called a hydroxyapatite. The matrix equals a hydroxyapatite. So what's the formula for the matrix? It's calcium, 10, phosphorus, 6, and a hydroxyl radical, 2. That compound is the matrix of your bones. So let's look then. I see I skipped too fast to go to the skeletal system. I was anxious to get here today. So we'll finish this and then we'll come back to cells. I apologize. It's just, that's the way it went today. So why do we have bones? What are the purposes of bones? What would this class look like if you had no bones? Even worse than that, you'd be down to about this size, right? All right, so you have bones for support. You have bones which will help you move, motion. So for muscle attachment. Fortunately, we have bones for protection. Obvious examples, skull protecting the brain, right? The sternum, the breastbone, the sternum, and the ribs for protecting the heart and the lungs. Sternum and ribs protect, well, we'll just put heart and lungs. And then we have calcium storage. We've just shown calcium storage. There's a constant exchange between the blood and your bones with regarding calcium. Constant exchange. Between blood and bones. People always say you take your calcium just for your bones. For muscle contraction, you need calcium. For nerve conduction, you need calcium. It's a terribly important element in your body. And then the bones have storage for bone marrow. Bone marrow will, some of the bone marrow will form red and white blood cells. Red and white blood cells. Do you know what the term is for the formation of blood in general? Hemopoiesis. Hemopoiesis. Hemopoiesis, good guess. Hemopoiesis is the formation of blood. And that's going on while you're sitting there now. You'll learn how many millions of red blood cells you're forming every second. Do you feel them? Isn't it remarkable what goes on, and you don't have to pay any attention? So we have red bone marrow in the infant is in most skeletal bones. Red bone marrow in infant most bones. In the adult, red marrow only in certain bones. What are they? We can list a few. First, the sternum, your breastbone here. Next, the ribs. So let's put sternum and ribs. And we'll come down. Can you see? Does the camera get this for you? Not too well yet. It's coming. Thank you. I appreciate that, Luis. All right, next place, what's called the crest of the ilium. Put your hands on your hip. We touch our bodies, it's okay. This is anatomy. So put your hands on your hips. Crest of the ilium. And then the bodies of the vertebra. It's a little hard to see it there, so we'll get out our box of tricks. You never know, do you? There's a body of a vertebra. It will have red marrow. Another place where you'll find red marrow will be in the proximal end of long bones. So if I talk about this bone, is red marrow going to be here or here? Here? Yeah, that's proximal, right? This was distal. So the proximal end of long bones. Okay, say you want a marrow sample. Where are you going to tell the doctor to take it from? How many want it in the sternum? How many want it in the ribs? How many want it in the crest of the ilium? How many want it? I'm not getting any hands. Got a coop. How many want it in the proximal part of a long bone. What's closest to the surface? Not the bodies. The bodies aren't, the spines are. Yeah, I'd really want it in the ilium, because it's right there at the surface. I don't want it here. What if they jab that in too far? Right? Can't hurt too much down here. Anyhow, crest of the ilium is one place where you will have hemopoietic tissue and you can take a sample. So let's see now. That covers all of that. Let's look now at classification of bones. Please. Those are long bones, right, because they have the basic structure. When we study embryology, you'll see how bones are developed. And the ones here develop the same as these. All right, I don't want to take too many questions during lecture because we have a lot to cover. Okay? Thank you. Yes? That was up there for a long time. We work fast in this class. So you, but he's in the way? I can't understand you. We'll get things worked out. This is only the second day of lecture. But anyhow, what I want to do now is give the classification of bones, because you've somehow got to learn all the names of the bones. And I feel it's easier to do it this way than to just give you a chart and tell you memorize. So we're going to look at classification of bones. So let's first take long bones. And we'll take upper extremities. And you'll see why we call them upper extremities. We're talking about this appendage here. So the first long bone is the humerus. Humerus. The humerus is your arm bone. We don't call the whole upper extremity the arm. This is the arm of the upper extremity. It was the arm. Then we have the forearm. And the forearm consists of the radius and the ulna. Radius and ulna. That's the forearm. Which is medial and which is lateral? The radius is lateral, right. Radius is lateral. Important to know. How many have broken a radius? No? Oh, one. Right. All right. Then we come on down to the palm. These are long bones. So we have the metacarpals. These will be the bones in the palm of your hand. Anatomical position. And then the phalanges. Phalanges. And the phalanges are the fingers. Let's go on down to the lower extremity. But having these broken down this way allows you to be very specific when you're talking. When you go to your doctor, so many students enjoy it because they can be specific about their bodies and say, well, it hurts over here by my radius, and they have it just there. All right, so we want lower extremities. And we know the first one. What's the first one? What's this one? What is it? Femur, sure. Femur. The femur is the thigh. What bones are in the leg? See, you've always called this lower appendage, the whole thing, a leg. It's really a thigh and a leg. So what are the bones down here? Whoops. Can you see him? Where is he? Where is our help? No, I was just bragging about you, that you are really good. So I want you to live up to what I've been saying. Well, I went to other websites to look at other professors, and the person up there was so far behind everything the professor was talking about. And I said, mine is it? Mine's right there. So I bet you he's going to be there right from now on. Right. So here is the leg. And laterally, don't need this chair here. Is that in your way? Is that okay? All right. We have the long, thin bone, which is the fibula, and the medial bone, which is the tibia. So we have the leg is the fibula, and tibia. And the fibula is lateral. How many have broken a fibula? This is only one, two. Healthiest class. It's amazing because it is so long and narrow that if a bone's going to break in the leg, you don't break this heavy femur, you don't break this heavy tibia, but this thin fibula is frequently broken. So as we move on down, we come to the metatarsals. Metatarsal, and this will be the sole of the foot. And then we have the phalanges, which will be the toes. All right, those are lists of long bones. And we'll be using these all the time because we've got to bring muscles into them. This is just getting our basic skeleton. So we want now short bones. And the short bones will be those of the wrist. They're shaped entirely differently than these long bones. So in the wrist, we have the carpal bones. Carpal bones, or carpus if you want, just the noun. And in the ankle, how many people have broken an ankle? One. Only two, three, four. Did you really break your ankle, or did you break part of your tibia or fibula? People call these bulges down at the bottom here ankle bones. They're not. They're part of the leg bones. Your ankle bones are way down here. The tarsal bones. Tarsal bones. Or tarsus. Then we have irregular bones. So irregular bones. Obviously, the vertebra are very irregular. No sacrum. Rattling my bones, right? Sorry, but I was hoping we'd have all the bones available. We can use the sacrum here on this. Here we have what we call movable vertebra, right? Every time you bend over. So we have vertebra, which are movable. and we have vertebrae which are immovable. And here they are fused. So the sacrum is fused and the coccyx is fused. Immovable would be sacrum and coccyx. Very irregular bones. And we can mention a few others. In the skull, it's difficult to see them from the surface, but this is why you need your books. You'll go into your books, you'll see the structure of these bones. But I can just point out where they'll be. They're irregular bones inside the skull, the ethmoid and the sphenoid. Ethmoid and sphenoid. So you'll see those as pieces to understand them. But again, you get an automobile accident, you crush this skull, and you've got to build it back up again, you have to know exactly where these bones are. We have the upper jaw is the maxilla, it's irregular, and the lower jaw, the mandible, it's irregular. So we have the maxilla, that's upper jaw, and lower jaw, mandible. Irregular bones. There will be more. I'm giving examples at the moment. Let's look at flat bones. Flat. Let's take the scapula because it's so obviously flat. You can see it at the posterior, superior portion of the back. Scapula is a flat bone. What's a common name for it? Shoulder blade. Shoulder blade. The blade is actually the spine of the scapula. That's where it gets its name. That's a blade. That's no blade. That's the spine of the scapula. Another one is the clavicle. Clavicle. What's the common name for your clavicle? Collarbone, clavicle. We'll see these again when we put muscles on them. That's collarbone. Then I'll give you two more that are in the skull. The one that's in front, what are you going to call the bone that's in front? Frontal bone. Don't always look for it hard, it can be easy. Frontal bone. Now, what do we call the wall of the skull? Parietal. So we have the frontal bone and the parietal. Parietal. We'll use that term a lot for wall. So it gives you an example of how you can learn the names of the bones if you try classifying them. Now, let's look, I think that's sufficient there, at some of the identifying characteristics of bones. Identifying characteristics. Let's first take a fossa. Fossa. What's a fossa? It's a depression in a bone, a depression. What's the example I'm going to give? It's called the temporomandibular joint. We know the mandible is going to be involved. This bone is the temporal bone. So it's the temporal mandibular joint. There's an indentation there to allow us to do this. Indentation right there. That's a fossa. So the TM joint, as it's abbreviated in medicine, TM joint is the temporomandibular joint. Let's take a sinus. What's a sinus? There are all different kinds of sinuses in the body, but with the skeleton, the sinus will be a cavity in the bone. A cavity. What's the example we're going to take? We're going to take the maxillary sinus. How many have had infected sinuses? Quite a few. So you have cavities in certain bones. A cavity in the maxillary bone is the maxillary sinus. Maxillary sinus. Let's take a next one. Foramen. What does a foramen mean? A hole. A hole. They say you have holes in your heads. Sure you do. You have lots of them. They're naturally there. It's usually used as a derogatory term, though. Foramen. Foramen. Foramen equals hole. Where is a large, obvious hole in the skeleton? That's a pretty big one, isn't it? You know what it's called? Foramen magnum. It's how the spinal cord gets up into the brain. So we have as our example of a large foramen, the foramen magnum, and it's at the base of the skull. There are lots of foramen. I just wanted to give an obvious big one. Base of skull. And it's for the continuity of the spinal cord with brain. We'll see that you can't separate the spinal cord from the brain as we go along. Now another term that's a common one is the meatus. Meatus. As I said, we will be repeating these all the time. This is just your first introduction to give us a background to start with. Four, meatus. Does anybody know what a meatus is? It's a tube, a tubular structure in the bone. Example, the external auditory. External auditory meatus. So, we have to get sound waves to come into the auditory receptor. It has to go through the bone. It travels through the external auditory meatus. So this is for sound waves. We'll see it when we study the ear. Now, let's take an entirely different bone. Let's look at the femur, the distal end of the femur. See, you can just pick out a bone right away. You know that's femur, right? That's the way we examine you. We give you a box of bones and call out one, and you've got to get it for us. All right, that's a femur. And what do we have that's unique on the femur? Are what are called condyles. Condyles. Condyles are large, smooth surfaces, curved surfaces. So they're large, smooth, curved surfaces. And the example is on what bone? Femur. Proximal or distal end? Distal. They're here. This is a head. It's different. See, this has to be here for this sort of thing. Right? This is down here to articulate with the knee. So these are at the distal end of the femur. We have a few more of these to go, but he's clicked the lights to let me know it's time to show slides. So we'll show slides. But again, if you keep up with this every day, review your anatomy, then by the time we build it all together, it will be fun. Right now, it may seem like you're getting a lot, but it will be repeated. Do you know how this one works? I can't get a light from it. Have you tried one of these before? That's a new kind. Don't look at it.
Forward.
I need the pointer.
There it is. It's
which is, yeah, I tried it, but I couldn't see it. Does it show up there? Yeah, there we go. All right, let's go through our slides to review what we've said. And some of this we didn't get to. We've got to come back to our cells. So we begin with cells, and we talk about the granule cells. And you can see why they were called granule cells. These little tiny things look like granules. These are granule cells in the cerebellum. They're the smallest cell in your body. They're only 4 micron. We'll give this next time. There are just two of these slides. Granule cells here. Next one. This is an anterior horn cell. Look at the difference. It's 135 micra. This is your big motor cell. For me to be moving this pointer now, my anterior horn cells in my spinal cord are firing. But you see the difference in size between the largest nerve cell and the smallest nerve cell. In the next one, and this will be endothelial tissue. Single flat cells. Do you know where in your body you look like this? This happens to be a cross section through a vein. We'll get these later, but I'm giving the example of a flat cell so you can see them. Look entirely different from those nerve cells you saw. These are endothelial cells. In the next one, these are cuboidal cells. These are around ducts. In the next one, these are nerve cells, most varied cell in the body. In the next one, and here we have our friend the skeleton. We've talked about long bones, the humerus, the radius, the ulna, the metacarpals, the phalanges, the femur. Here's the weight-bearing tibia and the very thin fibula, which only has muscle attachments, down here, the metatarsals and phalanges. We saw the crest of the ilium. We saw the bodies of the vertebra. We talked about the ribs having hemopoietic tissue. The sternum having hemopoietic tissue. The mandible being an irregular bone. The maxilla being an irregular bone, the frontal being a flat bone, scapula being a flat bone. Next one. mandible, irregular, TM joint, a depression, a fossa. Put your fingers on your TM joint and make your jaw open and close. Just feel it. Become familiar with it. Then we had the maxilla, the upper jaw, the frontal, the parietal, the side. The ethmoid will be inside, and the sphenoid will be inside. We can't see it from these views. In the next one, now this is just to show the sphenoid. What did we say we could tap in the sphenoid, in the sternum? What's here? Hemopoietic tissue, right? That's your sternum, or you could go to the ribs. In the next one, now, what's this large curved surface at the distal end? Condyles, good for you, but see how smooth they are? Who's had a knee replacement? Nobody. Different age groups, right? Next one. And this is for those of you who are going into imaging to see what a nuclear magnetic resonance image looks like of the knee with the condyles. We'll learn the rest of the structures. This is your fibula here coming up to articulate at the knee area. In the next one. And on this one, it's the proximal end of the femur where, again, you can tap for hemopoietic tissue, for bone marrow. In the next one, I think that's about it. No, this is a foramen magnum. Next one. That's it. Fine, thank you.